Jacked and tan.
Are we
going?
Yes,
sir. How you doing? Welcome to the podcast.
Can you turn to us live?
It's been live. Don't you hear Ryan's computer screaming the whole time?
Tucci, phone's down, bro. This is fucking live and real.
Phone's down, cocks out.
Buddy.
Oh, we're on.
Oh, we're on.
Are we on?
Ladies.
Oh, shit.
We're never off around here.
Look. I thought you guys did a whole intro. Ladies and gentlemen, live from New York City. It's Saturday night.
Kenny, I think you think this is way higher production than it is. We're all in the same hotel room together, the four of us, in Dude Ranch.
The intro is my mom.
Yeah. Saying welcome.
She has recorded our intro for us.
Really?
Because the podcast is called Mama's Boys. That's why I had you on.
And that's why, Kenny, why do you think you're on? You're definitely a Mama's
Boy. I am a fucking Mama's Boy for sure. I went to an Elton John show this week.
Yeah.
And I took my mom with me.
That's some good stuff.
Yeah, I've taken my mom as my date many a times.
Elton John's amazing.
Yeah. All right, Elton John's fantastic.
We've talked about him too much.
That
we're
farewell
moving on.
Concert, I was going to say. What? It's coming up. He's doing his farewell tour.
Yes.
I'm going to see it in Toronto when it comes out.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's
I heard Toronto is a great place to go.
It's amazing.
You should come up.
Just in general.
I've been to Toronto many times.
I love
my best friend, who I was the best man at his wedding 2 years ago.
This is
he's
so
from Toronto.
Mike would say that he feels you're his best friend, so I just don't know what's going on.
You can
here.
Only have
Buddy,
one
do you
best
think
friend.
Like that?
Yeah, look at you. You know, you just got more handsome in front of these lights and this microphone.
So your best friend, sorry, I got
He's from Perth, Ontario, but he lived up in Toronto for the longest time. And I was actually up there again for another buddy, his wedding this summer.
Okay.
But I love Toronto.
I did
great
too.
International city, and it has a ridiculous amount of beautiful women.
And that's
where we're
subject
going.
Of today's podcast.
Before the podcast.
For those that don't know, go ahead.
Yeah, one, his name is Mr. Beautiful. No. And now this podcast has just become Team Beautiful.
Yes, but hold on. Let me say this because you know, you guys were throwing this around last night when we were hanging out.
And
you
guys,
I'm self-proclaimed.
Why are you sensitive right now?
I thought you said that.
I am
when
not
I saw
self-proclaimed.
You, in Solace, you said they call me Mr. Beautiful.
Yeah.
And then you said self-proclaimed after to me. That's what I heard. I'm not trying to misquote you.
I would travel a lot when I was on TV.
Yeah.
And I
what
go
were you
everywhere.
On, Nickelodeon?
Supposedly. According to a bunch of fact guys on the outskirts of Boston. Yes, I was on Nickelodeon. I wish I was. My career would have probably lasted a little longer. Regardless, I would travel all around the world.
Yeah.
And women and men of many different cultures and nations would say, oh, super guapo. And Mr.
Isn't
Handsome.
That just
and
one
I was like,
isn't that just one nation?
No,
then?
No.
I was in Germany. I was in Germany. And they said,
buddy, mucho guapo. I was in Russia. And they said,
it was Spain. All right, Mexico.
Two places.
Australia.
Puerto Rico.
Okay.
I was in Guam.
Yep.
I was everywhere.
I was in Antarctica.
Brazil, although mostly Portuguese-speaking country, there was a lot of Spanish-speaking people down there, and they kept saying how handsome I was in many different languages. I forgot how it goes in some of the other ones. But I said, why does everyone keep saying this? I got to run with this. So I kind of adopted it as my
thing. Branding. We were talking about branding also. But so we probably only have three and a half ladies that are listening right now.
3.5.
Hundreds of thousands of men, though.
It's an odd number.
And so,
heavy set, gentlemen.
Yeah, well, I don't know about all of that. All right, that's judgmental.
Some are big bones, some are peach boys. It's fine.
But you were talking about there's three aspects that we need to attract opposite sex. You were saying there's three tiers or something. Then I cut you off. Please continue with your methodologies, your theories of maybe the woman's psyche or how to attract a woman or how to even meet a woman in today's 2018 society. Today, Junior.
Okay, so in today's society, now, normally, I grew up, right? Because I'm a little bit older than
you. Yeah, same generation.
I grew up
older.
In a time where you actually had to spit some game, talk your shit, you know?
Yeah.
Nowadays, it's like you just slide into the DM. So I think the first criteria is you have to have a decent social media game. And what I mean by that, if they go and check your page and you're a complete fucking weirdo and all you're doing is putting up fucking lifting posts and shit, then they're like,
we're just going to throw daggers the whole podcast.
Let me tell you this.
Like 700 pounds.
Hey, talk to me, Rugrats, the fucking Nickelodeon.
Buddy, let me tell you this. Hold on. Yours is more dynamic than that. You're not giving yourself enough credit as well. No. I just started following you as well.
Oh, thank you.
And you guys aren't just putting up, you guys lifting. You have this other side. You're a little artsy. You like to dance. I mean, you teeter-totter on the fence a little bit.
Yeah. Where a woman might see his Instagram and be like, is he into women? I don't know.
Yeah, I was like, maybe he might not be interested in women, which is fine.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Hey.
All right, but he's got a strong.
He's casting a large net.
Yeah, he's throwing
everyone.
It's not just the poll.
Up your chances. Yeah, numbers game.
He's throwing in there, and whoever gets in gets
it. Dude, I got an A in statistics.
So,
go for Mike. I'll take what I can get.
So you got to have a decent social media game.
Yeah.
You got to show you're not just one-dimensional, because even when you can find the hottest girl on the internet, if she's only posting pictures of your ass, you're like, well, she's probably half brain dead because she can't make a video. She can't say anything because, you know, there's a couple of people, and I don't want to name them, or maybe we should, who only post pictures of their ass because—
I'm right here, Kenny.
Because they have nothing else to offer.
Right.
So that's fine.
Yeah.
They're good for a smash session, but that's it.
But we're not talking smash session. We're trying to find Kenny a wifey.
A wifey.
We're trying to find a wifey. So,
everlasting love.
Look, the time's ticking, bro.
But I don't need it. Beyond that point. I'm old. Nobody wants me. I'm over the hill.
Kenny, potentially because you got too much damn love and support from your family, from your mom, too much fulfillment that you don't have that need, maybe? Is that part of it? What is it?
I don't know. I never thought that deep into it. Yes, I would say I got a great support system at home.
Because I'd say I feel the same way.
And you know what I think it is from one mama's boy to a couple other ones. You're like, am I ever going to meet a woman who's as good as my mom?
Yeah,
yeah.
You know, it's weird and sounds fucking.
No. You want a good human, a supportive human.
So you're like, the looks will fade. I mean, she's got to have that now because then you know. You know,
you know what? Yeah. I don't know.
What do we need, Kenny?
Yeah, you need that stimulus.
a spark to light the fire.
Can't start a fire without a spark.
Thank you, Bruce.
True.
Yep.
Bruce.
So what are the three tiers? So social media is one of them.
So yes, right. So nowadays, you have to have a social media. Because if you're not on social media, then you're like, whoa.
So do you think social media—
Who the fuck is this CIA agent?
Either you're a convict or—
Yeah, you're a complete creep.
So is the social media nowadays, talk about going back to 10 years in your generation of hitting on women, that's the opening line or that's the first look? That's the same thing now.
That's like your step in the door.
Yeah,
you're like, okay, because everyone internet dates now, right? Yeah. I mean, who's met a girl who hasn't met her on the internet in the last—
Yeah, Tinder, Grindr, all that.
Tinder, Grindr, Instagram, Snapchat.
Okay, so tier two.
Tier two. You have to still be able to have a personality, right? Because everybody's like, I look so good. I look so good. Everybody's so obsessed with the way they look nowadays. But you have to be able to fucking talk some shit.
Yeah.
So your internet is the way you get in. Your social media game is the way you get in the door. Then, all right, then it's how you talk.
What if you don't have that? What? Do you think that's nature? Do you think that's nurture? What if people don't
have charisma? You just described the entire
Lonely finds lonely because a lot of good-looking people who have no personalities.
Real recognize real. Lonely find lonely.
Lonely find lonely.
True.
And they'll find each other and be like, oh, you ain't got shit to offer. Me neither, but I look good, so we might as well fucking get down and dirty. So,
Barbie and Ken.
What?
Barbie and Ken.
Exactly.
I was going to say just quickly, that basically kind of describes, and myself and Mike have talked about this, that a lot of people that have YouTube channels, so their social media, Instagram, but YouTubers that do fitness or run fitness, they have slick edit game, like it's very strong. They're able maybe to talk in front of the camera in short bursts. It's the way they edit it that makes them seem entertaining. But then you talk to them in person and they're kind of like cardboard.
You do a podcast.
They feel their physique is basically all they need to be successful.
Yeah, or post-production. You have a live crowd, whether you're doing stand-up comedy or a seminar or even teaching a class, something like that, or you're the life of the party even, or a podcast. Now we're taking away these tools and your personality.
Well, you can't hide from the bullshit. Yeah. I mean, there's plenty of people where like you start following them, you're like, oh my God, they have 500,000, 600,000, 700,000 followers. And then you watch their videos and they're like, yeah, this motherfucker's annoying.
Yeah.
Why does he have so many followers?
Yeah.
Oh, because he has abs and he's jacked.
Yeah, but and like even some of the like you see some of these people. I started following this girl for a little bit.
Let's call her out.
What? I don't even know. I tell you the truth, I don't even know her fucking name. She actually came into the gym and she did a bunch of like cool shit. I was impressed by what she did. But like all her videos were so fucking obnoxious. It's like, all right, today I'm waking up. It's like, oh God, this is fucking atrocious. I can't fucking have this in my feed. I got to get rid of it.
Yeah. Everyone has to be, you know, we've called it before the headline generation, where everyone, because everyone's trying to get that attention, everyone's kind of yelling in the
street. Exactly.
Not saying anything of substance. So you'll see a vlog and say, hey, what's going on, guys? I can't believe I woke up today and today's going to be the best day of all time. I'm like, what?
Well, like, who's got the best podcast?
Well, Mama's Boys,
aside from you guys.
Oprah?
What are you going to say, Oprah?
Rogan.
H3, I like his
very
podcast.
Very good, but both are very good. Yeah, Ethan from H3, and Joe Rogan are top in the nation.
What does he do?
And Joe Rogan, right, has always got that subtle intro. He's like, hey, what's up, guys?
Freak, the
Joe. Well, I think marijuana plays a role, but.
Yeah, he's got that subtle intro. It's that fucking old school cool. It's like that James Dean, the fucking cool hand Luke. Hey, what's up? Like, you don't have to be this loud, obnoxious motherfucker. when I start class every day, I'm like, hey guys, let you know, this is how we're going to do it. It shows a level of like, hey, I don't need to fucking yell to impress you.
So what if you're not born with that, born with the gift of gab?
I don't think you're born with it. I think you develop it. I think it's a level of comfort that you have in front of other people.
Okay.
A lot of people feel like, all right, guys, and you're like, nah, chill the fuck out, because you can tell this is the first time you're here.
Yeah. You know? You're kind of freaking out. I want to add one more when you said, James Dean, Cool Hand Luke, Paul Newman's a great one.
Yeah.
Marlon Brando.
Yes.
In The Wild Ones, there's a scene where he basically orders a beer and it's like the most gangster thing, but he's talking like barely above a whisper.
Yeah.
But he just commands respect by the way he does it, which is like the opposite on social media. It's like how loud you are, like how rich you are, like how big your abs are, how big your muscles are, all those sorts of things.
Well, you know what? I always say I have a bunch of man crushes. I mean, everybody crushes on The Rock, but I think a guy who doesn't get enough man love out there from other dudes is Josh Brolin. Like, he's one of those fucking dudes where, like, every movie he's in, I'm like, this guy's fucking cool, man. I want to hang out
with
him.
The only movie I like to was The Goonies. No, I haven't seen The Goonies. The Goonies, bro.
Nobody knows that. There's a lot of people. Yeah, bro. He was the brother. He's the only brother. It's amazing.
Oh,
but just think of the roles he plays. He always plays this super fucking cool, chilled out. Like, I loved him in American Gangster.
Yeah.
You know?
I like American Gangster a lot.
Great movie. And he makes it, like, him being that, like, that cop in New York City, you're like, this motherfucker's a bad dude.
Yeah.
I loved him in it.
Moving on to tier three.
Oh.
So we have the social, we have the Instagram, we got the first representation.
Personality.
We have the gift of gab, personality, some depth.
Yeah.
Tier three?
I'd say tier three is, you know, that ability to be honest. You know,
speaking truth.
Go on.
Because there's a lot of people out there, and nowadays it's savagery, especially here in New York City. I always say this. I'm a big fan of not leading people on, right? Everybody's like, you see these people who are chronic daters.
Yeah.
I haven't had a fucking girlfriend in 5 years. Yeah. Only because you meet somebody and you're like, unless you know it could work out or it's going to work out, like,
Don't lead them on.
You know, you could be like, hey, listen, I love having a good time with you. We're both adults. We could fuck. We could hang out. I like spending time with you. And we could maybe develop something over time. But to be like, all right, let's date right now. You're like, hold the fuck. Pump the brakes.
Do you think that's an old, experienced Kenny talking?
No, I think I've always been like that.
I feel like I've always been like that too.
Yeah.
Just because you don't know. I want to bring it back though, Kenny, just to the concept of mama's boys. Because I do feel like my mom's phenomenal, like A1. We feel like our moms are the best. We have that social support and that kind of home life.
That you're okay to be alone.
That you're fine to be alone. The emotional fulfillment. And so all too often I'll see this, you'll go on a date or whatnot, and somebody wants to hop right in and say, well, wait a minute here. It's like, I just got to know you. It's like, who knows what both of us want? We don't know, right? And a lot of people, I agree with you, will lead individuals on.
Yeah, I think what it is, men and women alike, or whatever you identify as, are lonely.
Yeah.
Especially the internet makes you lonely. Well, social media has made you more lonely because now it's like we have that instant gratification.
Yeah.
Even for myself, like I used to sit at home and play fucking video games. I used to sit at home and draw. Like I was an art major. I used to love to just sit home and do it. Now it's like I check my phone even when I just checked it 30 seconds prior to that because you want that instant gratification. Yeah. Everybody wants that. So, you know, for me, and I'm sure it's even worse for younger kids who only grew up understanding this, that they're like, I need somebody. I need attention. Yeah. I need to be with somebody. Like, there are nights where I'm like, I'm fucking perfectly cool being home.
Yeah, yeah, two things. I talk about being alone a lot, but there's a huge
difference. I read your thing the other day. I thought it was pretty good.
He edited it.
I was going to say it was way too.
Definitely my concept.
Way too deep for him.
My concept, his words. But being alone and being lonely are very, very different. I almost never feel lonely, and I love being alone, kind of like you just mentioned. And then going back on your third tier, which is amazing because it foolproofs the other two tiers. Because you can fake the other two.
Yeah, for sure.
You can fake the other two. Yeah. But if your truths are your truths.
Shows depth of character. I was also going to add, I forget what research they were showing, but when designing apps, it was just a segment on 60 Minutes, that addictive quality where they want you checking that instant gratification.
Mm-hmm.
Where you
see that point system.
Oh, what happened? Yeah. Why do you think we have likes on Facebook or likes on YouTube videos? The same idea on Instagram. Yep. Like, how many did I get? How many followers? Oh, someone sent me a photo. It's like, are you fine with just either being alone or not communicating or being connected with everyone all the time?
Yeah.
And you said also kind of that idea. I think it does build a little bit of apathy or that feeling of or a fear of missing out, as they refer to it.
FOMO.
Yeah,
FOMO.
You see everyone having a good time. You're like, damn, like I wish I had a girlfriend like that. I wish I had this life. And so you feel like you're not good enough, or maybe there's something out there that you're not experiencing.
Yeah, and that's what happens. You're always looking at your phone. You could be with the most beautiful girl in the world, the most handsome guy in the world, and then you're like, oh shit, what the fuck is this? This looks interesting. Maybe I should fucking take my chances at that.
Yeah. Yeah. And that goes beyond women. It goes beyond men. It goes to career. Sure. Which is
those three things apply to everything.
I agree.
They apply to business. They apply to relationships
Branding,
between men and
men. Yeah. Or marketing. Yeah.
Well, even with friends, even with higher employees, everybody's like, well, what's the first criteria to work at your gym? Like I get people who are sliding. I want to work for you. I want to come to your gym. And I'm like, the first thing is like, I got to know that you get along with the team. You know, I was watching this documentary actually on band. I forget what band it was. Anyway, I love like old school music. I love like hearing about like the formation of the Beatles and Led Zeppelin and, you know, a lot of these older bands. And one of the things they were saying is like, when a guy drops out of the band, to replace him with somebody else is so hard because you have to find a great musician. So that narrows everything down.
Yep.
Then you got to find a guy who can mesh with the rest of the band. Then you got to find a guy who's so cool that you could get along with for 3 years on the fucking road. So
day
now
in,
that,
day out.
Yeah. So now this pool of thousands of people gets narrowed down to maybe three guys.
Yeah. Or less. Yeah.
So you're like, oh shit. So it's the same thing with employees. It's like, I need to know you're going to get along with the staff. You're okay with the way we, you know, kind of operate. And, you know, I'm not structured. I hate corporate America. I hate that structure. I like, listen, you know what you need to do is your job. Just do it. I'm not going to yell at you. I'm not your parent. I'm not your boss. I'm here, like, I guess I'm in charge.
Yeah, yeah. Facilitator.
But I want you to go on a stewardship and you do the best you can be. Because if you're good here, later on, you're going to be better at your next job because I'm going to refer you and you're going to have the skills to become better at whatever you're doing. So if you're a fucking garbage man, be really good at being a garbage man. If you're a personal trainer, be really good at being a personal trainer. If you're podcasting, be really good at that. Because if you're good at one thing, you're always going to be good at something else. I tell people, invest in people, don't invest in, you know, an idea or a business or anything like that. If you invest in people, good people will always produce good shit.
Yeah, yeah. Sometimes, networking.
And sometimes it's fine to get it wrong. You made you talked about the Beatles or Led Zeppelin, classic rock reference. Sometimes you get it dead wrong, as is the case with Van Halen, where David Lee Roth left. And then Sammy Hagar joined, and it was an instant shit show. Anyone that likes Sammy Hagar should just be excommunicated.
So I was going to ask you.
Oh, no.
So hold on.
Uh-oh.
I wrestle with it because I love David Lee Roth because he was the—
Have you ever read his autobiography, I was going to say, Kenny?
No.
Because you said you like the formation.
Read I've
his
read,
autobiography,
yeah.
Crazy from the Heat. It's fantastic.
Really? So yeah. I read Slashes, which was awesome.
Yep.
I read The Motley Crue, which is actually becoming a movie soon. The Dirt.
Yeah, yeah, that's good.
That's going to become a movie soon.
Really?
Yeah, they just casted like the four main guys.
I turned down that role.
I read Gene Simmons' book, which was fantastic.
Yeah, Gene seems like an interesting guy. They're two.
He is so over the fucking top. Yeah, like, he's never done drugs, doesn't drink.
Oh, yeah.
The guy crushes ass still to this day. And
you know, crushing ass, East Coast, West Coast is so great because crushing ass on the West Coast, farting. It's
like you're crushing ass in the West Coast.
Isn't that different?
I don't know, dude. What'd you say the other day? Tagging out there is like fucking like your cattle. Like you're tagging fucking cattle.
We don't have much cattle here in New York, believe
Yeah, you were talking about ladies that way. It's 2018, Kenny. We don't talk that way.
There's a funny story about the Axl Rose shared because Paul Stanley, I heard a lot of shit about Paul Stanley from Kiss. Where you try to recruit, and what's funny, Van Halen, they share a commonality with Guns N' Roses, and then Gene Simmons tried to recruit Eddie Van Halen for his band in the early 70s. So I'm huge into Van Halen.
No shit.
Huge into
I love Van
a lot of rock, yeah.
You don't think Van Halen had more hits with Sammy Hagar?
Well, it doesn't matter about the album. So if you put on their first six albums, Van Halen 1, Van Halen 2, Women and Children First, Fair Warning, Diver Down in 1984,
That's you are against, fucking huge, man.
Yeah, he's deep into the art.
So first, Eddie's guitar
playing.
I
thought I was the only idiot who knew.
No, no, okay, don't worry. I think Eddie's guitar playing wasn't nearly as good in 5150, OU812, or Fuck the album, or Balance. Yeah. They did have more hits.
They have an album just called Fuck.
For Unlawful Carnal Knowledge, they call it.
That's great.
But what I was going to say is they became more like radio-oriented rock where they went for the hits. But if you look at the things that excited people, like a Hot for Teacher or like a Running with the Devil, Eruption, a Panama, Girl Gone Bad.
They were more of a like a jam band. David Lee Roth.
Oh, yeah.
They, like, played out a little bit more, where Sammy Hagar, it's like they were going for the radio.
Yeah, they went basically—
Which I think was a testament to the times, too.
That they could also survive. Like, changing an artist. Have you ever listened—so here's a question for you, Kenny, just talking about rock a little bit, bro.
Yeah.
Is, have you ever listened to David Lee Roth's debut album, Eat 'Em and Smile,
with
Steve Vai?
That was the one with—
I'll take David Lee Roth. So he released an EP. So here's the short story of it. Dude, after this, you 100% need to read his autobiography. David Lee Roth is out of his fucking mind. I think he's actually a genius, but he's also a supreme narcissist. So it's this crazy—
I think any lead rock—
You have to be.
Yeah,
you have to be.
I mean, Vince Neil.
Oh, yeah.
Axl Rose.
Yeah.
I mean,
all of them.
Stanley. They were all fucking
rappers. Kenny Santucci. Hey.
I should have been a fucking lead
singer. Bro, that's what you should
have. The only thing I was lacking was a voice.
and
presence.
Let me put it this way. That didn't stop David Lee Roth. You know, I love the guy to pieces. But, like, if you look at, you know, vocal talent.
Yeah, he's not that good.
No, but he has everything else. But I was going to say, what's so interesting, crazy from The Heat, is his autobiography. His solo album, dude, he got the best guitarist at the time, one of the best, Steve Vai.
Yeah.
He assembled this, like, hit list of people, and then he released it and actually did well. The one that you're talking about, Just a Gigolo, he released an EP. Basically, there's friction with the band. They released 1984. It's like their biggest album of all time. Roth obviously wanted—
Which was a great album.
Oh, it's—
One of the best rock albums,
dude, of all time. Yeah, Girl Gone Bad and House of Pain are, like, my favorite, like, two songs in a row. Actually, Tom Morello from Rage Against the Machine said that if aliens came to Earth and we had to do battle, like a guitar battle against the aliens, he said, I would pick Edward Van Halen, like circa 1984, 1981, to go up against it. Just he had the frenetic ability of a Jimi Hendrix with also, at the time, technical prowess. People rate technicality, I think, too high, but he had just that feel. He's that kid that has that hot touch on the guitar.
Well, I'll tell you what. I've gone to see every fucking rock band, you know, Red Hot Chili Peppers, Guns N' Roses, multiple times.
Yeah.
Van Halen multiple times, you know. Bon Jovi, anybody you could think of, Coldplay, I've seen them all.
Listen to Coldplay?
Yeah. Well, you have to. I mean, if you're a rock fan, and you know, they're—
That's for the women out there. For, yeah,
it's a 40-year-old virgin.
I'm not crazy about them.
40-year-old virgin reference.
What?
What?
You know how to know you're gay?
You listen to Coldplay.
You listen to Coldplay.
I love rock and roll. I like the heavier stuff, obviously, a little bit better. I've seen Iron Maiden. You want to go to a place where there is no women whatsoever? go to an Iron Maiden concert. There's not a fucking woman to be found. Anyway, and there are two guitarists that you could watch for hours just play the guitar. It's Eddie Van Halen and Slash. They're magic on the fucking guitar. It's like they when they say a guitar could talk, those two motherfuckers, you're like, yeah, I could hear the words.
Yeah, they're a
it's
translator.
It's incredible. It's fucking incredible.
When did you see Van Halen? Was it with the reunion tour?
Hold on.
Oh, you saw it with Hagar?
I saw the Sam and Dave tour.
Yeah, you saw the Sam and Dave tour.
I saw the Sam and Dave tour.
God. That's 2002.
When they first came back with—
You're into it, Kenny. That's good.
Yeah, they
that's
came fantastic. Back with Sammy Hagar.
Yeah.
Then they came back with David Lee Roth.
Yeah,
then they
so did the Sam and Dave tour.
They came back with the Sam and Dave tour. And then when his son came on board—
Wolfgang. Yeah.
Played the bass.
Yep.
And they got rid of Alex—
Michael Anthony.
Michael Anthony. Oh,
so sad. That's a terrible choice. Yeah. What's funny too?
It's like, I get his son wants to be there. Have him play fucking backup guitar or something.
I know. Yeah, it's just disrespectful to the legacy. Yeah.
I'll tell you what. You want to watch a fucking great documentary that I almost it kind of changed the way I looked at a lot of bands and a lot of artists and stuff. I'm a huge Billy Joel fan. I have a wall in my apartment of just like show.
Kenny, I asked someone else this before on another podcast, so
we already know the answer.
Billy Joel. What is it called? Strangers, his album, which is fantastic.
Yeah.
And Scenes from an Italian restaurant. Is fantastic. Billy Joel or Elton John? Who would
Billy
you pick?
Joel.
Oh, okay. That's cool.
He just said he had a wall in his apartment.
I don't know if the other wall has Elton. You don't know.
If you told me I'm going to get stuck on an island and I'm only allowed to bring fucking one album, it's fucking Billy Joel.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
For sure.
Okay,
fair.
Yeah, yeah.
Just because he's got such a broad stroke with his music. He's got, you know, that old school rock and roll feel, you know, Only the Good Die Young, something like that. And then he's got Scenes from Italian Restaurant. It's got a
fantastic,
you know, She's Got a Way, you know, He's got such a broad.
He has a breadth in his catalog. I 100% agree. I'm saying, Kenny, you need now to listen to Eat 'Em and Smile, David Lee Roth. He has two good, actually, I'd say three solo albums. Skyscraper was the second one, but Eat 'Em and Smile.
I'm gonna have to get into it. Yeah.
If you listen to it, bro, it sounds basically like 1984 1.5. It's not as good as 1984. Yeah. But what's crazy is he left the band because he actually wanted to make a movie and a bunch of other things, and they just fell apart. You know, ego's gone the way because they're so big.
They said Eddie Van Halen's a fucking egotistical maniac.
I think you got to be. And yeah. then, you know, Sammy Hagar has had some things to say. But then, you know what? Van Halen would never be Van Halen without Edward Van Halen. I think he's one of the few guys that he—
He wrote a lot of the music too, though.
Who?
Eddie Van Halen.
Oh, he wrote all the music. Like 90% of it. Yeah, so Roth was the front man. Last thing I was going to say, I just found it interesting. So if you look, they had a battle. Eddie came out with 5150 with Van Halen.
Yeah.
And then David Lee Roth, within 3 months, came out with Eat 'Em and Smile. And if you listen to both albums, which one actually sounds like Van Halen? David Lee Roth.
Really?
Because he just like, he was in the band so long, got the feeling style. And Eddie wanted to stretch other ways. But, you know.
He was trying to do something else.
Yeah. There's only
that
one.
That doesn't work out for a lot of bands. But anyway, like I was saying, if you want to watch a great documentary, it's on Netflix. I was Netflixing and chilling one night, and I watched Hired Gun.
Okay.
It's about—
It's on Netflix?
It's on Netflix. And it's called Hired Gun. And I watch a lot of— And it came up as one of the recommended ones. It's a picture of like Pink and some guy on there. Mm-hmm. Anyway, there's like four or five guys who constantly get hired or were constantly hired through the 70s, 80s, and 90s.
Session musicians or what?
Session musicians who are like, yo, we can't get to— From like Chicago to Billy Joel to all these bands that are like— We can't get this sound right. We need to hire somebody who's really fucking good. You know, you have an artist who's good. These guys are really fucking good. They'll hone everything in and tighten it up. And I always thought Eddie Van Halen, because Michael Jackson had him come and play.
On Beat It.
Killed it. But he didn't write that riff.
No, he didn't. That was Steve Lukather. Or what. And that's one of the guys where we're talking about Hired Gun.
He's a hired gun.
No, that makes sense. Yeah, Quincy Jones. But I will say this. The guitar riff for Beat It was great. It is the solo that Eddie plays that makes it. You should check out, dude. I will check out Hired Guns. Have you ever watched the Netflix documentary 20 Feet from Stardom?
No.
It deals with the backup singers. So Rolling Stones, you know the song Give Me Shelter?
Yeah, the young girl.
They have all of them on. Like basically these people, they're better than the singers. Like Mick Jagger, they blow them out of the water, but they just don't have the maybe superstar quality that never made it.
So like it's going amazing. Back to Kenny's three tiers. Like if you don't have a, at that time they didn't have social media, but if you don't have a branding or a first response in a meeting, if you don't have the stage presence or you don't have to dance, but if you don't have a stage presence and then you have maybe the truths, which is your skill in that instance.
Well, I mean,
you need at least two out of the three to fucking be big. I say that all the time in podcasts or social media or reality TV or YouTube or whatever it is. You need like two to three things that you're really fucking good at to even have a chance. And then a little bit of luck and then a lot of work.
I say that all the time. I think it's a combination of a lot of things that kind of works out. I always use these two examples just because they're, you know, the closest to what I like. Is somebody like Superstar Billy Graham. Superstar Billy Graham was great.
Yeah.
Hulk Hogan took it to the next level. You know, Chuck Berry was great.
Yeah,
Elvis took it to the next level. It was that he had the rock and roll feel. You know, he just launched it. I mean, it was more accepting, obviously, in the 50s to, hey, here's this white Southern singer.
Yeah, it's easier to market, I think, Elvis than
Chuck. Yeah, he was a lot more marketable. Same thing with Hulk Hogan. Yeah. Billy Graham and Hulk Hogan were essentially the same fucking guy because Hulk Hogan took a lot of his shit.
I didn't even know that. Yeah. So he was a wrestler?
He was a wrestler in the 70s. Okay. And kind of, if you watch a lot of old videos of his whole shtick, he kind of took from Muhammad Ali and Hulk Hogan took it from him. And it was that, you know, WrestleMania was at that time. He was a big enough guy. He just launched wrestling into the stratosphere. That's when they were selling out stadiums with 90,000 people.
Crazy.
So that's what took it to the next level. Same thing with Elvis. It's like Chuck Berry's playing, you know, clubs all and arenas and stadiums and shit all over the South. Yeah. And then Elvis took
on
it
TV
to the next
and movie.
Yeah.
And
Elvis was on television and shit.
To the megastar level.
Yeah. So it takes it to the next level, which launches everybody forward.
It does.
Which is a good thing. It's like, I mean, was he the first king of rock and roll? No, but he's.
Yeah.
He looked at that.
Is he the one that brought it maybe to that next level?
Yeah,
it's like powerlifting or anything else.
It's like anybody else.
Yeah, there's tons of strong powerlifters, but who's going to bring it into the
real
life?
Who's the most influential? Well, it's not necessarily the strongest.
Yeah.
taking it back to like fitness, it's like I always say that about CrossFit. It's like, yes, Rich Froning won, you know, they always put him in the forefront, but he doesn't he lacks that personality or even that villain quality.
Do you think Kenny, because I don't really know too much about CrossFit, do you think there's anyone in the CrossFit community that has that superstar status?
Personality?
Yeah, to make
What they're lacking, all right? No. Why boxing is still irrelevant is because Floyd Mayweather plays a villain.
Yeah.
Right? No. And McGregor, right?
Yeah.
Has made
more of a Muhammad Ali style.
More of a villain quality as well. Like they have this... They're going to say some shit that some people are going to hate and some people are going to love. Yeah. It's that stone cold quality.
Yeah, yeah.
Polarizes.
It's some people are going to be like, oh shit, this dude's a badass. Other people are like, fuck him, he's an asshole. But that's what launches the whole genre. It launches everyone forward, right? So if they're now appealing to the masses, right? And everybody's there, you have to pick a side, right? They bring these fights. When have you watched a Floyd Mayweather fight and been like, oh man, that was great?
They're never that good.
But then it's a decision.
He hypes everyone up so far that everybody's so invested, either watching him win or watching him lose.
Yeah.
And I think that's what Muhammad Ali did.
Yeah, he was the
best. Great job. And then but CrossFit, the whole community is based around being supportive and being, you know, helping each other out. So until somebody comes along to demonize themselves, like, be the bad guy, and it'll be good for everybody. But everybody's like, so chummy. Yeah. I think Matt Frazier has the ability to be a villain.
I think none of the CrossFit athletes have done any of that well, but CrossFit as a company, that's probably what they've done best.
They polarized.
Yes. Not only polarized, but they've also created...
Well, Castro could be the villain, but he's not a competitor.
But they create storylines that aren't even there.
Yeah.
That's what CrossFit does well.
Powerlifting, we've spoken about this, how everyone's like, oh, and powerlifting has grown recently, absolutely. But they don't
Of CrossFit, weightlifting, everything's gone.
Yeah, it's all gone.
And they don't have those people then that could take it to the next stratosphere, either through rivalries. We talked about this before. You have competitions. You should have two guys going head-to-head, or two women. Was like, oh, this is a big deal. It just doesn't happen.
Yeah, or charisma.
Know? Sense of spectacle.
A lot of people at the top of these sports don't have charisma.
Like, they're pretty quiet.
Yeah, people, LeBron James.
To train like that, though, I think you have to be such an introvert.
But what about the other stuff, though? Like LeBron James and Michael Jordan, these guys train their faces off. Kobe Bryant, talk about polarizing. Like, you either love or hate Kobe Bryant, and he, I guarantee, trains just as hard, if not harder, than these CrossFit guys.
For sure,
you know, like,
for sure,
there's rumors of him being drafted here in New York on draft night. He's at the ceremony, walks up, shakes hands, gets his jersey, and then goes to the gym.
Yeah.
At midnight.
Kobe.
Yeah. I've heard crazy stories.
He's 18 years old, just out of high school, and was like, I better work out. I just made the NBA.
I watched one documentary or one interview with somebody where they were playing them, and he's like, yo, somebody else was on an opposite team, and he was like, yo, I'm gonna show up 2 hours before the game and go work out.
And so, oh, and he says,
and Kobe was there before he was there. There 2 hours. And it's like, holy shit, this guy is a fucking monster.
But, and so that guy,
you can't, like, that's somebody you can't beat. Like, you might beat him one game, but you're never gonna outwork a guy like that. Yeah.
He has a personality. He can talk a little bit. He's very motivational in a raw sense, in my opinion. When he talks, he doesn't have to tell you how hard he works. He can just put words together well and actually work out. And then two, he's super polarizing. People love him or hate him because he plays a little bit of a villain.
Yeah.
And he's at the extreme of a sport. He's literally good at one thing, basketball. You know, like whatever, Rich Froning or whatever name you want to throw out there. And but for some reason in the fitness world, even bodybuilding, whatever you want to say, they don't have personalities.
No.
Yeah, and then
what's up? So
it's so funny you mentioned that. Yeah. The Kai versus Phil Heath could have become an even bigger thing.
Yes.
If they would have played it. Yeah. And also, you know, just to be like very frank about it with Kai Greene, some of the shit that happened to him in the past, like his past history, I think prevents him from potentially winning an Olympia. And so he realizes that.
Yeah.
He retired, right?
Yeah. And he's retired. But yeah, he was a polarizing figure, I think, in a good way.
I love it. I watched his documentary. I watched Generation Iron.
Yeah, yeah.
One, two, three. I thought they were great.
There's a three, right? I didn't watch
I think there's a third one coming out.
Yeah.
I think he's a great personality. I think he could be the villain and he could be the good guy. It's like, there's a part of me that, like, kind of, you know, feels bad for him in a way.
He grew up in a foster home.
And he, like, made something of himself. And I think he's got an awesome story. And I think he's done a lot for himself up to this
point. But people don't do that like they do in the NBA, NFL.
It's rare. And then you do see guys like there was Rich Piana that came on stage, who was, whether you like him or don't like him, a very polarizing figure. Right.
And fairly charismatic enough.
Yeah, well, that's what's funny about the fitness community is that if you have those other qualities, so let's say you're jacked out of your mind and you fit those things and you have a little bit of personality, it goes a long way.
I was always attracted to like big personalities. I always, one of the things, I love it. Guys and girls alike. Yeah. I love a great personality. Even when I was a kid, watching wrestling, I loved wrestling as a kid. I mean, that's where the whole fucking Mr. Beautiful thing came from. I loved the villains. I loved the Rick Rudes and the Mr. Perfects.
Absolutely.
They were
The sense of theatrics.
Because I'm like, this guy, I know he doesn't believe he's this good looking.
Yeah.
Like, Rick Rude was an ugly fuck.
Yeah.
But he was awesome. Like, he would do such over-the-top shit. Like, the Million Dollar Man, they would do such. And as a kid, I'm like, I want to be the bad guy.
Yeah.
I want to be this guy. Yeah. I love the Ultimate Warrior. I loved Hulk Hogan. But as a kid, I'm like, these guys are so over the top and so fun. To me, like funny. Even as a kid, I'm like, man, he's fucking funny as a villain. So I'm like, that's who I kind of adopted. I guess over time, I started doing that. Even when I was on TV. Like,
were a little bit of the villain on TV.
Yeah, some people were like, loved me. And some people hated me. But I'm like, I don't give a fuck. I mean, I'm pretty.
You need to be a personality on there, otherwise you're just gonna be cast aside, right? Yeah. Isn't that
or not even cast?
Yeah, in the first place. You have to show that you have something to say.
Yeah, what did you tell me? I was asking you about the casting process with some of this, and I said something like, "All these people are just crazy or whatever." And then you said, "I wish I remember the exact quote because it was so good." But you said something about how you knew or why you knew they chose you. Because you're like, oh, like so-and-so's fucking crazy. Like, oh, this chick, she's an alcoholic. This chick.
You said something about yourself. Yeah.
Well, no. So we were, the first interview I ever went to, I'm up in Syracuse, New York at a fucking table full of 25 people.
And this is to get onto MTV Real World Challenge.
Yeah. And everybody at the table is like, this one girl jumps up and she's like, I fucking banged three guys last night. And somebody else is like, my parents don't know I'm gay. And I want to come out on television. Everybody's shouting fucking crazy shit. I'm like, fuck, I can't hang with this group.
Yeah.
I got nothing. So I was up there with this girl and I'm like, I'm just here to fucking bang her. I got no fucking plan. I actually don't have a good story. I get along with both my parents. So I don't have much. And they were like, all right, come with us. So I just was like honest about everything.
Yeah.
You know, I was kind of like, you know, polarized. You could see, you know, I have nothing to really hide. I'm kind of okay with most things. So, and I was really closed-minded at the time, and I'll be the first one to say it. Like, when I was 20, 21 years old, I've never left New Jersey. Yeah. The only thing I knew was Italian Catholics and Irish Catholics. Yeah. And, you know, I grew up in Newark, so it's like the only people I grew up around were, like, Blacks, Hispanics, and Italians. That's all I knew. So, like, you know, I'm meeting other people. I got on the show, and everybody there, all these other fucking white kids from Canada and Nebraska and Louisiana are like, you're Italian? What's Italian? I'm like, are you fucking stupid? I'm fucking New Jersey. That's all we got. <You know? laughs> We're the best, you know, creatures on the planet. I'm like, you know Bon Jovi's?
Have you ever got that Bon Jovi?
Yeah.
Bon Jovi.
Yeah, right? I'm like, come on. The greatest people. Do you know who Joe Pesci is? Yeah, he's Italian from New Jersey.
I like Joe Pesci. Yeah. He shows them. Yeah. Oh, my God. Not Frank, Robert De Niro, not Pacino.
Do you know Frank Sinatra? Robert De Niro's from New York. He's from Brooklyn, I think.
He is? Yeah.
Whatever, Italian.
Yeah,
he's in it.
Italian from the East Coast, you can't beat it.
Yeah, he has to. Have you ever watched his, I think he directed it too, for sure, A Bronx Tale?
Oh, fuck. It's a great movie. I've seen it a thousand times.
Mike, you've seen it?
I saw it. I went to go see the Broadway
play. Yeah, I saw it advertised it's before. It's a very good, very good movie.
Great story. Great fucking story.
Did he direct it just for the record?
I'm pretty sure. No, Chaz Palminteri. Robert De Niro directed it. Chaz Palminteri's like story, like it was the way.
It's fantastic.
Great fucking story.
There's a lot of kind of great New York movies. One that my mom likes to watch when it's on. She's not really into romantic comedies, but just this one, Moonstruck.
Oh yeah,
it's classic. There's a lot of
Tom Hanks in it.
Oh no, fuck no, bro.
I love Tom Hanks.
It's the one and only Nicolas Cage and Cher, bro. That's the one. Yeah, where he has a wooden hand. It's classic. It just seems like the city has a lot. When you said about you like big person. Personalities. You know, there's a lot of people in New York and the surrounding area. It seems like almost you have to have something to say or worth saying. Yeah. Otherwise, you're just going to be lost in the crowd.
I think when, you know, you hear the song, it's like so cliche. It's like if you can make it here, you can make it anywhere.
Yeah.
You will get lost in the shuffle if you're not fucking doing something, and you, it will bring out the best and the worst in fucking everybody.
Sure.
You know?
So when's the book, The Three Tiers of Success from Kenny Santucci, coming out?
Oh, fuck. God. When I could start to fucking read and write better.
There's ghostwriters and shit.
There's ghostwriters, man. Are you kidding me?
I'm going to need somebody. I'm definitely going to need a lot of help. I'm going to need somebody feeding me fucking Adderall just so I could pay attention the whole time.
Yeah. I think you could do it.
Well, I was going to say, because you mentioned about reading some rock autobiographies. Even Motley Crue, you know, The Dirt. Yeah, they spoke about, they basically, I would assume it was in an interview form where they'd just be shooting the
everybody.
Shit. And then there's the writer, and the writer adapts everything.
Yeah, for sure. You know, I don't think any of them wrote it, for sure. Yeah.
The only people that write their own books are people that fucking like write Harry Potter and shit.
The only person that wrote his own book was David Lee Roth, and he's off his fucking rock. He submitted for his autobiography, Crazy from
How's
the Heat.
How's that read? I mean, are the letters real big and shit?
No, Kenny, it's one of the most entertaining reads. I think it's my favorite rock autobiography. Just because, so he submitted the manuscript and then the guy adapted it, but he wrote it all out. It was originally, I think, 1,400 pages. Or maybe 1,200. And then they whittled it down to about 400. But each, it's like you're reading almost a stand-up book. It's amazing. Yeah.
I think there's so much ego. Like, I never think like, oh, hey, somebody wants to hear my story. You got to be such an egotistical.
Absolutely.
I say the same thing about politicians. Imagine, like, everybody's like, oh, I loved Obama. Oh, I love, I hate Trump. I hate this one. I hate that. But I'm like, they're all egotistical fucking maniacs. Yeah. To want to run this country.
To want that much power.
It's hard.
Yes. Yeah. I'd rather put a fucking gun in my mouth. Yeah, I would. If somebody's like, tomorrow, hey, you could be the president of the United States, I'd be like, fuck that shit. Because you never wake up on a Sunday and not have a pile of shit on your desk.
You see when
that affects those billions of people, not millions.
Plus, they know
billions.
Like probably government secrets. None of us know, like, you know. Yeah, we're joking about
the
conspiracy
fuck
theories
would want that?
About how we're saying different things, like whatever, like aliens, reptilian overlords. But like, yeah, they have access to everything. Imagine you finally become president.
You can find some weird shit.
Some weird shit that you're not supposed to. Yeah. So aliens contacted us in the 40s.
What are you gonna do, sir?
You should look at Kenny. There's a funny, like, they just did a compilation of the last, let's say, five presidents, when they entered office and when they left office.
Yeah, so
and
bad.
Everyone looks
poor
fucking
Obama.
Haggard.
Buddy,
poor
oh,
Obama.
Man. I always
That's
say
the
that Obama. Is when he
comes in looking like Fresh Prince of Bel Air.
Yeah, he
leaves
young,
like
Morgan
looks
Freeman.
Like Morgan Freeman.
Yeah, that, yeah.
He left. I'm like, man, those fucking 8 years really fucking
dude,
worked.
Yeah. No, because there is shit, right? Even this year, I think Trump obviously let out some JFK news that had been hidden or tucked away for the last whatever 40, 50 years.
Imagine hundreds of pieces of information.
Something
like
else
that.
About Area 51 was supposed to be released. That really? Trump said, yes, we have something and we're going to release it now.
Fuck I that. I don't even want to know.
We don't either. He was scaring me with the weirdest fucking. Well,
dude, I love that shit.
We do too.
But I hate it too.
Yeah, just I love it because it? I don't want it to be real. I'm so scared.
You really want to freak yourself the fuck out? Yeah. You ever see Zeitgeist?
Oh,
I've heard
of it. It's a documentary, right?
Holy fuck. I'm like,
is that 9/11 or no?
Yeah, it's 9/11. It's everything.
I think I've seen,
it's religion. It's fucked. I'm like, I got to stop watching this shit. I told this story the other day. I used to work at Port Newark. You know, Johnny used to work on
the
docks.
What the hell is that? What the hell is that?
Okay, so it's the shipping yard. So anything that comes in from overseas comes in through the dockyards.
Oh, cool.
So like on the waterfront, the big container ships.
Oh,
cool. Yeah.
Just like Marlon Brando on the waterfront.
Exactly.
Okay.
So I used to work there for years, right? And it was a fucking mob job. Right, you don't even fill out a fucking application for this.
Love it.
Like, you know,
that's
somebody.
Why you've been wearing this beanie. It looks like you just came up the dock right now.
You got to know somebody who knows somebody to get in. And it's a fucking, some guys have no-show jobs and whatever. But regardless, I worked down there. And in the morning, everybody would do the same shit. You go get a cup of coffee and you go get the paper. And I would read the Star Ledger, which is like New Jersey's paper. And you read the New York Post or the Times. And I'm sitting there at my desk one morning. I'm like 21, 22 years old. I'm going through the paper and I'm like, who died? This happened, that happened. It's all just fucking shit. Terror, travesty. And I'm like, yeah, fuck this. I'm done reading the newspaper. Yeah. And like, I think people are fucking nuts who get up in the morning and watch the it's like, everybody's like, well, you should be in the
informed.
Know. And I'm
like, it's like, that does inform you about anything.
It doesn't it informs me about everything shit that's going on. And then I love some of these like Facebook things that it's like, here's all the bad news. Here's like 10 great things that happened in 2017 that helped the world get a little bit better. And you're like, oh, fuck. Never saw that in the paper. Yeah.
We made a joke that there should be a good news network.
Yes.
Where it only promotes positivity.
But no one would watch
someone,
it.
Someone told us, I think either off camera or else
yeah,
mentioned.
Yeah, I had heard of it.
That someone started it and then it failed.
Someone tried to do it on YouTube and I heard it failed.
Yeah. But what does that mean it failed? Because on YouTube, it's a free platform.
No views and stopped.
Oh, okay.
It's the same way, like, you know, you wouldn't stop and like, sit there and watch a wedding, but you'll stop and watch a fucking car crash.
Or a fire. Yeah.
Like people
stand 100%.
Like everybody wants to get in on the fucking horror.
Yeah. It's
like,
true.
Oh man, people are getting married.
Beautiful.
That's beautiful.
Yeah. No, it's
go,
true.
Let me go
so
sit
true.
In on this fucking wedding. No, nobody does that. Nobody
the inner heart
shit.
Of darkness, bro, of humans.
Yeah.
Has been this podcast.
But that's the thing. I just actually bought this book. I didn't buy the book. I bought the audio book.
Fair.
So while I'm working out, I'll listen to. So I love reading about musicians and stuff, but I like reading a lot of these self-help books. And this book that I just got was, or audiobook that I'm gonna listen to is 12 Rules of Life.
Okay.
And it kind of starts to touch on this idea of like, everybody's like, oh, well, you should be happy and you should work towards happiness. It's like, no, you should work for the greater good.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, you might have to bend and twist for other people sometimes. And that's kind of, it only piqued my interest because I listened to the preview for it. And I'm like, a lot of times I'm like, fuck, this sucks for me, but it's going to be better for a lot of people. Even for like my staff at the gym, shit, I have no problem spending my own money and taking them out because I just made $100, $200, $500. You know, I hope doesn't make or break me, but it's going to change their life and it's going to change the
positive
way they look at
them.
Yeah. Where they're like, oh shit, somebody does give a
ripple
fuck
effect.
Me. Somebody wants me to get better. I say this all the time, like why I love fitness so much and why I continue to do it is because everybody's like, well, you're harsh on people and you make fun of people. I'm like, no, I'm like, if I can make somebody look in the mirror and be like, man, I feel great. I love myself. That's waterfall effect where they're going to now get in their cab and be nicer to their cab driver. Their cab driver's going to be go home and be nicer to his kids and his wife. And their kids are going to be nicer to their kids in school. And it kind of, if we could reproduce that, if everybody looked in the mirror and goes, man, I feel good. I love myself. Yeah. I feel
confidence.
Good. It starts with the individual, and then you could travel down.
I was talking about this rant. I don't know if I ever actually posted it, but I filmed a huge rant in my car on a drive one day about confidence literally solving, being the answer to world peace.
I think you
fuck yes.
Maybe
I
did.
Yeah, no, it was a good video.
Because if you were actually true confidence, every single human on the planet with what you have, who you are not, what you don't have, and you're actually confident, there would be no issues anywhere. There'd be no
There'd also
issues.
Be no bodybuilders. I'm just
joking. There might be because you get there to find confidence. You find confidence lifting weights. I don't think it would change that much. Obviously, this is impossible because there's so many issues in our society. Even the social media stuff you're talking about. But hypothetically, if that could happen, everything would literally just stop and be awesome. That's the one answer to everything.
Things would come together.
Because everybody's like, I mean, fucking terrorists and shit. It's like, oh, I want to go somewhere good. Why isn't
this
place
Or I want
this
country.
Good?
I want that country. Yeah,
why can't we make this place
good? Or respect my religion or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, fuck the Holy Land. The war for the Holy Land has been an endless fight for thousands of
But if you're confident that it's our Holy Land, it'll stop.
Or you're like, no, oh, fuck, well, it's no different. It's not like their fucking roses grow a little bit better than
People are just people, is what you discover at the end of the day.
So, I mean, I don't know. Maybe there's something we all don't know and somebody else is
like, that's why we got to be president.
That's why we got to become president and find out all those deep, dark secrets.
Yeah. Tucci.
But I think even like with working out, like sometimes it's like I work out because I feel like it does release some sort of,
like bad vibes
it's
that you
like,
got.
Yeah,
yeah.
You just feel
you
good.
You feel better after.
Like, I worked out. 100%. And I'm like, I feel better now after I worked out than I did. So it's I think everybody. I mean, it's human nature to want to feel better.
Yeah.
And if we all feel better, if everybody's working out, it's how do you feel when you don't work out? You're like sluggish. You're tired.
Yeah.
You know. And it, now multiply that times 1,000 when you never do anything.
Plus the issues. They don't even know the other side.
They don't
work out.
No.
Yeah.
That's the thing. And you know that. That mentality, when I first became a trainer, fuck, like 10 years ago, people are like, what are you going to do for money? What's the point? You can't do that for the rest of your life. I'm like, I got into it because I'm hoping to do it for the rest of my life.
You can create a path.
I want to do it for the rest of my life because you see these guys who even, you know, who've spent their whole life working out, you know, some of the fucking, you know, Jack LaLanne and a lot of these guys, you're like, man, this guy worked out to the day he died. I mean, yo, he wasn't fucking power cleaning 285 anymore, but
jacked enough.
But he was doing his thing. He felt good.
He found a career too. That's when people say, there's no money in that. There's no money in this. We're like, some motherfuckers found a way.
Some guys do real fucking good.
Yeah.
So. Kenny Santucci, where can people find you?
At Kenny Santucci.
Yeah.
Solace Gym, Manhattan?
Solace, New York.
S-A-N-T-U-C-C-I.
Yeah.
Buddy, what's on the horizon?
Well, we're still working on a strong New York's.
Cool. So seminars?
Yeah, seminars. I want to do that just to kind of build the community. And those events, I want nothing from them. You know, I just do them for charity, and I do them as a, you know, it's called Strong New York because obviously I'm in New York, and I realize that we don't have a lot of, you know, I have to go out to LA. I'm going to the Arnold. There, nothing's here in New York. Yeah, so yeah. I want to do like a big fitness event.
That makes sense. New York is so big.
I know, but it's dude, we so different.
We have Comic-Con. We have the New York City Food Festival. We have the Coffee Festival. We have festivals for everything fitness.
Grammys.
Yeah. Grammys. So I want to bring fitness influencers here and show them that it doesn't have to be this fucking conflict.
I know.
We're the only ones. Anytime you meet like another trainer, it's like, it's a dick measuring contest.
I know, it's the worst.
Whereas like with, you know, other attorneys, there's like this level of respect. With other doctors, there's this level of respect. It's like,
yeah.
I'd like to
insecurity,
think
insecurity, bro. Confidence, if there's exactly. confidence.
Mike, going exactly. back to it.
I told you about my little fucking situation. Let's not bring it up. But it's like, there's this level of like, hey, man, you're treading on my turf. It's like, shut the fuck
up.
I don't care about you.
Yeah.
I didn't wake up this morning thinking about you, and I'm not going to go to bed thinking
about you.
So who gives a shit, you know? So my thing is like to pull the community together and to obviously establish not only physical strength, but mental, emotional, and spiritual, because that's what'll develop through that physical strength. I see it every day, and I that's what I love to do. You know, I say all the time, I told you when you told me Mark's gym was free, I'm like, fuck, that's my dream. I want to make a gym for free that anybody could come to have a youth program and do all this stuff. But I mean, I still need to fucking.
Yeah, logistics. You'll figure it out later.
Yeah. Stay on the road. I was going to say, Kenny, thank you for being on.
Guys, thank you for having me.
Check him out on Instagram. We'll have you back on.
Yeah, of course.
For another episode talking all about wrestling, because I heard you're big ups into wrestling.
Yeah, we'll get into that next time.
In the corner who's also all about wrestling.
Buddy, I almost power slammed him through this fucking table.
Buddy.
He was mouthing off a little bit. I almost had to give him the rock bottom through the table.
Kenny is a true mama's boy. We have a final question, perhaps, and we just want to know one thing, Kenny.
It's what? Over. It's over, dude. He already told me last night.
Oh, it's over?
Yep, do it. Do it, though.
I don't want to separate then. Dude, I don't want to create the separation. We don't need to talk about crepes then, bro. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it, Kenny. We'll just skip it.
Savory or sweet?
No. What do you prefer, crepes or pancakes?
Oh, you didn't ask me that.
Yeah, what do you prefer, bro?
What do you got?
Crepes or pancakes?
Buddy, it's tough because I love both.
There's one choice, whether you're in the inner circle choice. Or... Yeah,
there is a place that I want to take you boys to tomorrow.
Oh, no. What time's your flight, Mike?
2.
Oh, that's fine.
There's
where you
a
go?
Place tomorrow morning.
Oh, God.
That have you ever had regatta pancakes?
Oh, pancakes.
Pancake, though. Yeah, we're in.
Yes.
Oh, so it's a pancake.
It's a pancake.
There you go. So yeah, we're in. Pancakes.
It is... Gentlemen, bring two pairs of underwear because
you're better share yourself. Yeah. Bro, I'm in. All right, so you chose pancakes.
Pancakes.
Right choice. Yeah. That is, we only deal with people that take pancakes over crepes.
Yeah. Fucking crepers.
Felt that tension right there.
No.
Make sure everyone listening, thanks for listening to us, to give a like and subscribe on the podcast, on iTunes. Tell your friends about us. Mama boys, we out.
We out, bitch.